Say good morning, everybody. Today's message, I believe that, well, let me put it this way. My outcome after today's message is that it will inspire you to get closer to the Lord. And my prayer is that the Holy Spirit will guide me and help me so that I can accomplish that goal for us to get closer to the Lord. I mean, if we look back every year, I mean, one of the questions we can ask us is, are we closer to the Lord than the previous year? And I don't think it's a question of performance. It's a question of intimacy, like we are saying. So, Lord, did I walk closer with you? And I hope that today's message, that will be a seed in your heart to help you to just get closer and more intimate with the Lord. So the title of the message is Discovering the Future, Knowing the Riches of His Inheritance. The better you understand your inheritance in Christ, the better you understand your flight plan. So I've got a picture here, which I thought was very funny when I saw it the first time. It's a bird planning his flight plan, and he's now trying to allocate his seat for this flight. I mean, he's going probably to mid-Africa, where it's a little bit warmer in the winter, and it's important, the position. I mean, you don't want to fly in front, right? And you also don't want to fly at the back. And so those of you that fly regularly, or, I mean, those flights to Australia, it takes you time to get there, even China. I mean, you know. You want a comfortable seat. Me and Mariki once had a baby on board to Europe, and it's not that great. A point I want to make is that if you have a clear understanding of what is your inheritance in the Lord, you'll start to understand what is the flight plan. You know, if Mariki, when she was younger, they would go on these road trips, and she would say in Afrikaans, "Mapa, wanneer gaan ons uitspan?" Now, that's a big Afrikaans word for a little girl, but my wife does got some beautiful Afrikaans words. But you know, when you take the kids on the road, and they just want to know, are we there yet? I mean, you're going to Cape Town, and it's just outside Pretoria, and they want to know, are we there yet? And also what helps us is that if we have a clear picture on where we're going, it helps us and motivates us to be more engaged and more purposeful and more meaningful in our relationship with the Lord and with people around us. And the scripture or the text for today is Ephesians 1 verse 13. It says, "In Him you also trusted, after you heard the word of the truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, having believed, you were sealed with the Holy promise, or the Holy Spirit of promise, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession to the praise of His glory." Now, our story of humanity started in a garden. I mean, you're all familiar with the story in Genesis chapter 1. But do you know that our story ends in a city? It starts in a garden, but it ends in a city. And if we have a clear understanding of what is the city and what's going to happen in the city, and why am I personally involved, and what is my role in the city, then it makes the flight plan a little bit better, and you don't have to ask the whole time, are we there yet? Because you're excited about what is happening, and you know what the Lord is doing in your life to prepare you to be a citizen of this great city. So in the first three chapters of Genesis, we read all about the garden, and in the last three chapters of Revelation, we read about the city. But it's in between Genesis and Revelation that we see this great story of redemption. Because we all know something happened in the garden, and we're not in that garden anymore. And God promised Adam and Eve that He will restore. He promised humanity, He promised mankind that He will restore. And the redemption plan is the restoration of that intimacy that we had with the Lord in the garden. And we also will have that again in the city. And so the Lord redeems and prepares his bride to live with him in the city and to be with him always. And do you know that you and I am the bride of Christ? We are the church. And so God is preparing us to be citizens of this great city. Now, the first time I could pick up the city without typology or indications indirectly of the city earlier in Genesis is in the New Testament, where Abraham was mentioned that he actually knew about the city. And this scripture is Hebrews 11, verse 10. So in Hebrews 11, it's all the who's of the Bible. It's the giants of faith, those that walked with God and did mighty exploits in the name of the Lord. But it says, when he talks about Abraham specifically, it says in verse 10, "For he waited for the city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God." So Abraham knew that God's plan is redeeming you and me as citizens in God's city. And this is where we are heading, and this is what's happening in our life, is for us to be citizens of this great city. Philippians chapter 3, verse 20 to 21 says the following: "For our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body that it may be conformed to his glorious body, according to the working by which he is able even to subdue all things to himself." You see, this redemption is both an act and a process. So for us to change in this glorious image that God wants to that God wants us to become, it's a process. This redemption is something that makes us excited, because we know that God is busy with something greater than just ourselves. So righteousness is an act of redemption. It happens immediately when you and I just start to say, "Lord, I accept you as my personal Savior." And from that moment, through the confession of your mouth and believing in your heart, you are righteous. So it's an act of redemption. But then there's also a process of redemption. It is this sanctification, where we are in a process of becoming more like the Lord. Now, I know you will not smile, because this is not a very easy road sometimes. We have challenges. We experience trials, disappointments, loss. We are misrepresented sometimes. But it is in this process where God prepares us to become something that you and I don't really have, if we're honest with one another, a real idea. Because the word says, "I am preparing what no eye has seen and no ear has heard." But you are part of that plan. And you are currently in a flight plan. You are in a process working towards that. And we call this the redemption plan of God. Now, when we go through these difficult times, and we don't know where we're going, we don't know what is the end result, we don't know what has God in store for us, the trial sometimes or the difficulties can be a little bit overwhelming. But if you know that God is with you, and if you understand that God is busy preparing me for the everlasting life, and there's something greater than this world, then you know that there's a purpose in it, and it makes it a little bit more accommodating to walk with God every single day. Revelation 21, verse 9 to 10 says, "Come, I will show you the bride, the Lamb's wife." This is now you and me as the church. "And he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain and showed me the great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God." So this is my first statement, is you'll see it on the board. What has been lost in the garden will be restored in the city through the redemption plan of the Father. And that God is preparing you in your daily life and the journey with him. He's preparing you to be a citizen of this great city. It's going to be glorious. It's going to be something out of this world. We do not have a lot to measure it. Obviously, there would be a lot of things that will be familiar or similar, as we know how beautiful nature is. But I'm telling you, the vast majority of the dynamics of that city would be just out of imagination. We don't have that kind of imagination after the fall to realize what God is busy with preparing for you and me. So you may ask, what must be redeemed? That was lost in the Garden of Eden. So Adam was not born, Adam was created. So I just want to get this picture maybe in your head. When God created Adam, there weren't a baby on a nice patch of grass there in the garden. He was a matured human being. Now imagine Adam before the fall. The glory Adam expressed from his craftsman, the Lord Jesus Christ. The innocence. The virtue. I mean, when we saw Adam, we saw God's perfection in something that he created. In Afrikaans said it was die kroon van sy skepping. Humans before the fall is something to write home about, I think. It's a being that is innocent, powerful, and reflecting the very image of God. And now Lucifer, which was also described as a very beautiful being, but distanced himself from God, the more he created this distance between himself and God, the more he lost this beauty of God. And all that surrenders him now is darkness and fear and doom. But when we think about Adam and we think about Adam before the fall, it was the glory of God's craftsmanship in a being. And we lost that image of God through the fall, through disobedience. But this redemption plan from the city to the garden, it's from the garden to the city, it's important that we book our flight plan because we are in for something. God wants to prepare you and wants to restore that image that he had before the fall. When the image of God was impaired in man by the fall, the definition of our purpose was also twisted and we lost sight of our inheritance. After the fall, as a result of disobedience, the great redemption story of the last Adam began. The Father sent the Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior, our Redeemer, our sacrificial offering, a suffering servant. God offered up his only Son so that he may not be served, but that he would serve others. The Lamb, sinless and pure, was laid upon the cross to invite the righteous back to the table of the Lord. The sacrifice is what evokes our victory over death. It's also put in this old hymn, as I just want to read this old song, "Your gift of love, they crucified. They laughed and scorned him as he died. The humble king, they named a fraud and sacrificed the Lamb of God. O Lamb of God, sweet Lamb of God, I love the Holy Lamb of God. Wash me in his precious blood, my Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. I was so lost, I should have died, but you have brought me to your side to be led by your staff and rod and to be called a child of God." I mean, God, the Father sent the Son to be our Savior, to redeem us, so that we can be restored back to the image that was lost in the garden. So that when we are citizens of this great city, that we will radiate the glory of God. Because as we've seen in the scripture that we've read earlier, is that He would change even this lowly body to a glorious body to represent Him well in the city. I don't know what is going to be your role. I don't know what's going to be your function. Maar ons gaan nie die heel dag op harpe speel nie. It's going to be very practical and it's going to be very functional. And God is already preparing you through what you are experiencing on a daily basis to be ready for your purpose and your call. And when we know that this is where we're going, it makes it a little bit easier when things get tough and when it's not that great or it's not working according to our plan. So the Son is the gift to humanity from the Father, and the Bride is the gift to the Son from the Father. In John chapter 1, verse 12 to 13, but as many as received Him, to Him He gave the right to become children of God. So when the redemption plan started, when we acknowledge that the Lord is our Savior, He gave us the right to be His child. In that moment, God already wrote our names in the book of life. It actually a census of who is a citizen of this great city that we will live for all eternity. And you can enter the gates, you can enter the city when your name is in this register of citizens. The redemption, if we read further on that scripture, it says in verse 13, who were born not out of blood, nor of the will of flesh, nor of the will of man, but that is born of God. So we are born of God, and this gives us this inheritance in this great city. Redemption is God's plan to restore our right to be His children and to walk again in the fullness of our inheritance in Christ. As we are redeemed and begin to recover the image of God, we will also start to walk in our full authority, including authority over death. Our nature is to rule, but if we rule before we have been restored in the image of God, it will be perversion of authority. If we seek to be like Him more than we seek authority, we can be trusted with more authority. So it's important that when we receive this great authority as a citizen in this in the city, that our image has been restored fully. Now, with salvation, we can already see how we become stronger in the Lord. What I'm meaning with that is that in the beginning, when you were a young Christian, some of the challenges were very difficult for you to go through. And it's almost like you've been a baby in the spirit where you are still learning the word, you're still learning the Holy Spirit, you're still learning more how to be victorious over the day-to-day challenges. But as you become more mature and as you develop in your sonship with the Lord, then some of the challenges that you go through today, it's much more of a challenge than those in the beginning years when you just started to walk with the Lord. Because the Lord works with you with a very specific purpose, preparing you for greater things. And when you are successful and when you are completing a certain trial and a challenge in your life, then it means that you are ready for whatever faces you next, and you are more mature and you are less of yourself and you are more of the Lord. And we know that the Lord, He gives us this authority of sonship, so we are more than conquerors if we identify with that identity and image of the Lord. So, I know it's a lot to what I'm trying to convey this morning, and it's for me very difficult. So the only way I said I'm not going to make another 15 minutes just to continue on this pace. So I'm going to start with a simple story in the Bible, that all of that I've explained right now, that it will give us a very simple, practical indication of how this is working. So the story is in Genesis chapter 24. It's a love story. Much of you will love the story. It's a, and it's all about Eliezer. It's the servant of Abraham. So the characters in the story is Eliezer, the servant, and he represents the Holy Spirit. So every year, time we talk about the servant, you know that he's a type of the Holy Spirit. We've got Rebecca. And so Rebecca represents you and me, the bride of Christ, right? And we've got Isaac. Isaac is Abraham's son, so he represents Christ. And we've got Abraham. This is now the father. Now, let me just give you context before we start the story. So here in Genesis 24, Abraham is about 140 years old, and Isaac is 40 years. And Abraham's wife, Sarah, has passed away 3 years ago. So if you read Genesis chapter 24 in the beginning, it says that Abraham was old and very stricken in age, and he was 140. It sounds that he's just going to die, but the good news is he's still going to live for another 35 years. Okay. But the Lord has blessed him in everything, including giving him a son, Isaac, by his primary wife, Sarah. And he looks like and acts like if he's about to die. But Abraham, like I said, he's going to be okay. It's another 35 years going on. All right, so Abraham is concerned about his son Isaac. The man is 40. It's no tight. He's a very desirable bachelor. I mean, you can just imagine the wealth of Abraham. So, I mean, if he would have been on one of these dating sites, would be maybe one of the top five there listed. Okay. So Abraham called in Eliezer, and he said to him, you got to find my son a wife. He asked him to swear that he would find a wife for his son from his own family. So this is where the problem is now coming in. He asked him to swear, and he's got to find this family, but they were in Haran. And Haran is about 800 kilometers away. I think there's a picture on the board quickly, if we can show that. So this is where Abraham was coming from, going to Israel today. But this is now where the servant must go back again to go and find his wife. So let me just give it some context. So it's where Richmond is. So if Google Maps, I tried to figure out what is about 800 kilometers from Rustenburg. There we go. That's what it's going to take to get there. Those time, 10 camels, 20 to 25 days. When we go there, how long is it? 8 hours, 35 minutes. I mean, this is so ergy. This is 25 days, worst case scenario. You don't know what's going to happen. It's going to be safe. And there's a lot happening in those days, right? And he's actually living around the Canaanites. And Abraham don't want a wife from those tribes because they are just immoral. They're not loyal. They don't know the Lord. I mean, that's why the poor servant needs to go 800 kilometers to go and find a wife from his family. Nonetheless, big city. It's a trade route from China and also India. So it's not a small city where he's going. So you can just imagine the servant going to the city, and where do you start to look? I mean, he doesn't have Google or Facebook to go and look. How does the person look like? Where's the family situated? I mean, he's got no references except the Holy Spirit. Right. This servant is a type of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit says out those that God foreordained. And he collected you. And maybe you don't know the Lord here this morning. The Holy Spirit is searching for you because you are the Lord's bride. And there's a zeal. The zeal of the Lord is driving the Holy Spirit to find those who are His. So let's read from verse 12. Then he prayed, this is now the servant, Lord God of my master Abraham, make me successful today and show kindness to my master Abraham. See, I am standing beside the spring, and the daughters of the townspeople are coming out to draw water. Maybe it be that when I say to a young woman, please let down your jar that I may have a drink, and she says, drink, and I'll water your camels too, let her be the one you have chosen for your servant Isaac. But this I will know, that you have shown kindness to my master. Before he had finished praying, Rebekah came out with a jar on her shoulder. So when she comes, Rebekah, out of the well, and she sees a stranger that she didn't know and asks for water, now she was not putting on her best date behavior to be attractive to this man, because she did not know he was looking for a wife for a very wealthy guy. She was just living her life as usual, taking care of her tasks. I mean, she was not aware what will happen if there would be an interaction with this man. She was just herself. So this is the story of Rebekah. I want more for you than I want from you. It's this song of nothing else. It's a worship song. It goes like this. I'm caught up in your presence. I just want to sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything. More than anything that you can do, I just want to be with you. I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open my heart to you. I mean, it talks about the same spirit that's here in Rebekah. I mean, she does not want to water or help the stranger because she can get something out of it. She is just being herself. And you know what? If the world will know what God is busy preparing for us and what He's willing to give for us, they will let go of all that power, all that wealth, all that fame in an instant. But this is how God tests our hearts. Are we willing to give? Are we willing to love? Are we willing to worship the Lord when things are not going according to plan? Are we willing to give everything to the Lord when nothing works out? Not for a week, not for 3 weeks, for 2 or 3 years maybe in your life. Are you willing, for not seeing any result, no harvest on the field, are you still willing to worship the Lord and just to be yourself? Because when you see the Lord in the city, you will not but help to fall on your knees or on your face when you see Him. It would be easy to worship Him. The challenge will not be to worship Him there. The challenge is to worship Him now. And if we can have the heart of Rebekah, where we just say, Lord, I just want you. I just want to love. But the good news is that God saves everyone that will just show some interest and just say, Lord, I recognize that you are the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. And then the zeal of the Holy Spirit will pursue you and prepare you for something that you are sitting here and I'm standing here today cannot imagine. You are something special, not because of who you are, but you are special because of who God is and how He has created you in His image. And if we let go of our fears and our anxieties, our insecurities, our lusts, our desires, all of these things that is from this world, the Holy Spirit desires that for us, and He leads us into the full truth. Because the more we let go of these things, if we are willing to let go of the difficult things, there would be an image of God that will come and be more tangible and more realistic in your life that you can ever imagine. We see people like that. There are people on earth today that really show such a great splendor of the Lord. But it's nothing to compare to when God restores us into this glorious body that He has in store. In verse 17, it says, "The servant hurried to meet her and said, 'Please give me a little water from your jar.' And she said, 'Drink, my Lord,' she said, and quickly lowered the jar to her hands and gave him a drink." And I was wondering there, did he know? He was thinking probably, is this the girl? I mean, we're so close, we're not there yet, but I mean, at least she's offering me a drink. But the camels, the camel still needs to come. Listen, there are 10 camels. And I'm going to look at gallon and liter. This is 75 liter. It's 75 liters of water that those guys drink. She would have been busy, but she still offers. Yeah, now I'm jumping the story, but you know, she's offering to also to water, to give water to the 10 camels. This tells me something about Rebecca, that she is a diligent woman. She's a hard worker and she's willing to take the initiative to help someone else. She is sensitive to other people's needs and don't think she planned to draw hundreds of liters of water when she came down to the well that specific day. And the servant is seeing some of these traits. Look, I know none of us here is perfect. There are a few things in your life that we are not proud of. But let me tell you, there are a lot of things in you that God created that's amazing. And if we just let go certain things, and if we just take our confidence in the Lord, those brilliance of what God created in us, it comes forth. And this is never for ourselves. It's to reflect not how good we are. It's to reflect how amazing and how powerful and glorious is the Lord Jesus Christ, the creator of all that we can experience. When the camels was finished in verse 22, drinking, the man took out a gold nose ring weighing a beka and 2 gold bracelets weighing 10 shekels. Then he asked, "Whose daughter are you? Please tell me, is there room in your father's house for us to spend the night?" Oh, okay. Camel's been checked. Well, servant water checked. Camel's water checked. Room to stay. 10 camels. Oh, it's a tall order. Nonetheless, the answer is yes. But listen how the servant represents the Holy Spirit. When she was willing to serve, to follow, she was rewarded with gifts. When we start to give our hearts to the Lord and we are now righteous, oh, the Holy Spirit just start to bestow gifts on us. He blesses us. The Lord blesses us. Not just in physical blessings, but also in spiritual blessings, like you rightly said. And so this is what the Lord wants for us. He wants to bless us. A very particular thing also happened now. There was one thing he did not pray for, and God answered that anyway, because we're told in verse 24, she told him she was actually who she actually were, and she was a relative from Abraham. So if we compare other scriptures, we can see that she's actually Abraham's great niece. So he didn't ask it in his prayer, the servant, but he was blessed that day because she was exactly what he was looking for. Isaiah chapter 65 verse 24 says, God says, "Before you call, I will answer, and while you're still speaking, I will hear." It is just a reference to his prayer. I mean, he was still busy praying, and then she appeared. I believe anything to do with your flight plan, if you ask the Lord anything around your flight plan to prepare you to be a great citizen of the city, it will happen very quickly. But sometimes we pray what I want and what's my needs, and there's place for it. But I'm telling you, things accelerate when you pray according to God's perfect will in your life. We're almost done with this story because I'm now at verse 28 and 29. So the young woman ran and told her mother's household about these things. By the way, in verse 16, it says that the woman was very beautiful, a virgin, and no man have ever slept with her. She went down to the spring, filled her jar, and come up again. So she was nog mooi ook. So, ding het mooi uitgewees. It's a good story, this one. Now, Rebecca had a brother named Laban. So, you know this guy. He, in the future, is going to have a story with Jacob, right? Yeah. He's going to work twice as long. So, when he saw Rebecca with all of this jewelry, ching ching, you know, he was just thinking, you know, he said nowhere. You can read it. So, it says, the young woman ran out, told her mother's household, verse 29, now Rebekah had a brother named Laban, and he hurried out to the man at the spring. As soon as he had seen the nose ring and the bracelets on his sister's arm, he had heard Rebekah's tell what the man said to her. He went out to the man and found him standing by the camels near the spring. Come, you are blessed by the Lord, he said. Why are you standing out here? I have prepared the house and the place for your camels. All right, it's typically Levan. If we read on in the future in the Bible, some chapters on, you'll know what I'm talking about. The next morning, I'm done. When they got up the next morning, he said, it's the servant, send me on my way to my master. Here we can also see the heart of the Holy Spirit, send me on my way to the master. John 5, verse 19. Very truly, I tell you, the Son can do nothing by himself. He can do only what he sees the Father doing, because whatever the Father does, the Son also does. Can you see the Holy Spirit also just want to, he has a role, he's got a function, he's got a task, assignment, and he needs to get to his master. But the brother and mother replied in verse 55, let the young woman remain with us for 10 days. But he said to them, do not detain me. Now that the Lord has granted success to my journey, send me on my way so I may go to my master. Then they said, let's call the young woman. So they asked Rebecca, hear Rebecca's reply, I will go. The Holy Spirit is calling the bride of Christ to go. The world, which is the other city, it's the city of Babylon. It's becoming more prominent. It's becoming more reality. We can see it in the culture today. And citizens are fleeing into the gates of Babylon. We know it's a false religion, and we know, if you know end times, what's going to happen. But the Holy Spirit is calling out the body of Christ to say, we must go. And are you saying to the Lord today, in my life, let's go. I'm going to lay down the things of this world, the desires, and I'm willing to follow the Lord with my whole heart, to worship Him in truth and in spirit. About 2,000 years later, another woman at the well met the Savior Himself, which didn't have a good track record. But the Lord saved her that day. But she was willing to let go. And are we willing to let go so that we can follow the Holy Spirit, so that He can take us to a very specific place? In verse 66 and 65, let me start at 65. Well, let's go 64. Rebecca also looked up and saw Isaac. She got down from her camel. I just think sometimes we got to get down from our horses, our ego, our pride, and just follow the Lord. Who is that man in the field coming to meet us? He is my master. The servant answered. So she took her veil and covered herself. Then the servant told Isaac all he had done. Isaac brought her into the tent of his mother, Sarah, and married Rebecca. See what is the end of the story. She was taken to a place that was prepared for her, Isaac's mother's tent. The Holy Spirit, as we said in the first verse that my text for this morning, is that he seals us. It's the zeal that drives us to become the bride. He pursues us the whole time. But there's a seal that he seals us. This seals means that when the Holy Spirit seals us, it means that there is a stamp, there is approval of great authority that you are the possession of the Lord and that the enemy cannot steal that except when you choose not to be righteous anymore. But the good work that the Lord has started in you as the bride of Christ, he will complete it. It's a signet ring that's been placed on your life that you will be this citizen of this great city. Now, when the trials comes, and the scripture that says we enter the kingdom with many trials, it makes it a little bit easier to know that we can we can go through it because we are part of something bigger than ourselves. In 2 Timothy verse 2, verse 21, it says, those who cleanse themselves will be instruments for special purposes made holy, useful to the master. So I want to encourage you to set yourself apart, to go with what the Holy Spirit wants to do in our lives, so that you can be an instrument for something very special. Many of you must be going through one of the hardest or one of the most interesting seasons where you've, over the last couple of years, maybe transitioned into big things, or you're still in a transitioning. This has been one of the most intense seasons of God realigning so many people for his purposes that we can't yet see. Many of us can't see the full purpose. If we want a higher rank in God, we have to set ourselves apart. God has you and he is setting you up for something to play a part in something that's going to have so much more impact than you can understand. And it's not only for year, but it's for eternity. Like what God's preparing you for now is going to have an effect into eternity. I just want to encourage you to be sensitive for the leading of the Spirit in your life. He's preparing you not just for what you need to do here now in this season, but he's also preparing you to be a master citizen of this great city. What we've lost in the garden, it will be restored in this city. And I just want to say, go with the Lord. The seal, the authority of God, it's been given to the Spirit of the Lord to guide you and lead you in the full truth of the Lord so that you can be released into his full image. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for your wonderful word. And we want to answer the call. And in your word, the call means proskaleo. It brings momentum and direction. And I pray, Lord, over every individual, Lord, where your zeal is pursuing them to answer their call in their life, that you will give them momentum and direction. Not only for what is now, but also, Lord, for discovering the future, knowing what is your inheritance for us as children of God. Thank you, Lord, when it's going tough and when things doesn't make sense, when we go through the loss, the disappointments, Lord, that we'll know that there's something bigger going on and that you will give us the courage and the wisdom and the understanding to know how to deal with these difficult times, but that we'll be inspired by what is coming and what would be the end result, so that we can plan our flight plan to be part of your great inheritance that you've set apart for us. In Jesus' wonderful name. Bless us today. Bless our families as we are spending time with one another and glorifying your name. In Jesus' name. Amen. You must have a wonderful, wonderful Sunday. Enjoy it. And may you also encounter a blessed week. May the favor of the Lord be with you. May He help you with your decisions. If you ask Him, we talked about it earlier this morning, if you ask the Lord, He can and will give you answers to give you strategy, purpose, and direction. Bless you.